فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
And then the Sheikh Rahimahullah Ta'ala carries on and he says, وَأَمَّا الْمَرْأَةُ فَيَجُوزُ لَهَا أَنْ تُحْرِمَ فِي مَا شَاءَتْ مِنْ أَسْوَدٍ أَوْ أَخْضَرٍ أَوْ غَيْرِهِمَا مَعَ الْحَذَرِ مِنَ التَّشَبُّهِ بِالرِّجَالِ فِي لِبَاسِهِمْ. And he says that the woman, as for the woman now, this is for the, that was for the man. The woman now, it is allowed for her to wear whatever she wants, whether it be black or green or any other color, as long as they should, but they should stay away from imitating men. They should stay away from imitating men. وَأَمَّا تَخْصِيصُ بَعْضُ الْعَامَّةِ إِحْرَامِ الْمَرْأَةِ فِي الْأَخْضَرِ وَالْأَسْوَدِ دُونَ غَيْرِهِمَا فَلَا أَصْلَ لَهُ. As for some people, you find that some people, they actually specify for women that they should wear black or green. The Shaykh Rahimahullah Ta'ala says, this has no basis in the Sharia. Meaning a woman can wear any color. A woman can wear any color and she's allowed to wear whatever she wants except for the niqab and also gloves. Specific gloves, gloves which are made to fit her hands or her fingers. Those are the two things which a woman is not allowed to wear when she's in the state of ihram. And niqab. And the niqab, what we're talking about when we say niqab, is the face covering which is has a hole in either one eye or both eyes. Or as today we have it, it's completely, the eyes are, you know, completely showing like that. This niqab is not allowed. But what is allowed, especially for those ulama who say that the niqab is wajib, or covering the face is wajib, or they say that the awra, that the face of a woman is awra, they say that a woman still has to cover her face. And how does she do that? She puts something loose on her face. يعني a khimar, something like that. Something, or a sheet. Now, that's what a woman does. But she's not allowed to wear niqab, specifically niqab or burqa. She's not allowed to wear that. Because those are something that are multasuk, they are connected to the face. And the Prophet said, لا تنتقب المرأة ولا تلبس القفازين. The woman should not wear the niqab or gloves. So these are the two things which the woman is not allowed to wear specifically. As for anything else, the woman is allowed to wear. She's allowed to wear shoes, socks, shirt, everything, about everything. She's allowed to wear everything except for these two things, which is the niqab and the gloves. That's what the woman is not allowed to wear. Then he says, ثم بعد الفراغ من الغسل والتنظيف ولبس ثياب الإحرام ينوي بقلبه الدخول في النسك الذي يريده من حج أو عمرة لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. Then when a person finishes this, he's come to the Ihram, to the Miqat. He's taken his ghusl and he's trimmed his moustache and he's done all the things that we mentioned. He put perfume on and he's plucked his armpit hair and he shaved his pubic hair. And there's a benefit for this, that a person should pluck the armpit hair. Pluck, not shave. Pluck the armpit hair, that is the sunnah. And I think anything that does istisal al-sha'r min al-asl, anything that takes the hair from the asl, from the foundation of the hair, that is the sunnah. And so that's why the Prophet said, netful ibt, to pluck the hair. And I think waxing does the same job, but I'm not sure. But if it does, it takes the thing, it takes it from the root, then it takes the same ruling as plucking. What does cream do? Huh? Anything that takes the hair from its asl, it's qaida. Anything that takes the hair from the asl, from the base of the hair, meaning it's not shaved. You know, when you if you shave, you still feel it, right? If it's completely taken from the asl, it's different. So if cream does that, if it takes it from the asl, then it's allowed. Then it's that is the sunnah. But if it just is a cream to shave it, that is not it. Even though it is allowed, but it's not the complete sunnah. The sunnah is to would pluck it off. And I think waxing does the same job. Naam, that is the sunnah. So when a person finishes all of that, he now goes into ihram. And ihram is niyyat al-dukhul fi al-nusuk. Al-ihram is niyyat al-dukhul fi al-nusuk. It is the intention to enter into the rituals of Hajj. It is the intention to enter into the rituals of Hajj. And the reason why we mention this specifically and we're emphasizing on this is that some people believe the ihram are the clothing that you wear. But a person, if he wears normal clothes like this, and he goes to the miqat, and he intends to be in the state of ihram, he is still in the state of ihram. In his heart, if he says, I intend to be in the state of ihram, then he is in the state of ihram. But if a person wears the clothing and forgets the intention, then his ihram is wrong. He hasn't done the ihram. And he has to go back and do his ihram again. You understand? That's why we say it is niyyatul dukhuli fi nusuk. It is the intention to enter into the rituals of Hajj or Umrah. That is what the ihram is. And then he says, وَيُشْرَعُ لَهُ التَّلَفُّظُ بِمَا نَوَى فَإِنْ كَانَتْ نِيَّتُهُ الْعُمْرَةُ قَالَ لَبَّيْكَ عُمْرَةً أَوَاللَّهُمَّ لَبَّيْكَ عُمْرَةً وَإِنْ كَانَتْ نِيَّتُهُ الْحَجُّ قَالَ لَبَّيْكَ حَجًّا أَوَاللَّهُمَّ لَبَّيْكَ حَجًّا. Then he says, then it is legislated for a person to say this intention. That's what the Shaykh says, that it is legislated for a person to say this intention. And he says, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ عُمْرَةً أَوْ لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ حَجًّا. And to say that this is an intention, to saying the intention aslan, what is the ruling on that? Some of the ulama, especially from the Malikiyyah, they say that it is a bid'ah for a person to say any intention. Meaning when a person is about to say, he says, no, wait, I'm intending to pray. When he's about to give zakah, he says, I'm intending to give zakah. This now, now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam here, he actually said when he entered into the state of ihram, he said, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ عُمْرَةً. Right? He said, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ, which is the intention for, which is the what you say when you go into the ihram. So the scholars have differed. Is this now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying his intention or not? And based on this, what the Shaykh says is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this speech is an intention. His saying is an intention. But what other scholars, what they say is that no, rather this is at-talafudhu bin-nusuk. It's just a person, he says what nusuk he's saying, but it's not his intention. And the dalil for this is that if a person says this now, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ عُمْرَةً, if I say لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ عُمْرَةً, does that mean I'm in the state of ihram now? No. Because the intention has to be in the heart. وَلِذَلِك we say the intention is only in the heart. And this saying, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ عُمْرَةً or لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ حَجَّةً, is not an intention. Rather it is التلفظ بالنسك, is a person entering into the rituals of Hajj. It is a person entering, not necessarily saying it, not necessarily, it's not the intention, it is entering into it. This is what you meant to say. So a person, he comes in, he says لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ عُمْرَةً, or whatever he wants to do. If he wants to do ifrad, he says لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ حَجَّةً. And if he wants to take the point down. The types of Hajj are three types. The first type is Al-Ifrad. Al-Ifrad is for a person to do Hajj alone, meaning his intention is only for Hajj, he's not for Umrah. So in this case, he says, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ حَجَّا. Al-Ifrad is for a person to intend to only do Hajj. And in this case, he says, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ حَجَّا. Second type of the nusuk is al-qiran. And in the Quran, it's also called tamattu' as well. Like in al-qiran, the fuqaha, they call it al-qiran. And that is for a person to do Hajj, al-umrah, and Hajj with one ihram. So he enters into the state of ihram. With that same in state of ihram, he doesn't leave the state of ihram. He does the umrah and the Hajj. So he doesn't leave the state of ihram. That's called al-qiran. And the third type of Hajj is al-tamattu', which is for a person to have two different intentions. His intention is for umrah, then he becomes halal. He leaves the state of ihram when he finishes his umrah, and then he does another ihram for Hajj. This is called al-tamattu'. These are the three types of Hajj that a person is allowed to do. The three ways a person can do Hajj. This is called Al-Ansak, Ansakul Hajj. And there are three. So whatever he wants to do. So if he wants to do Afrad, what would you say at the Ihram? If you want to do Hajj, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ حَجَّةً. If you want to do Tamattu', what would you say? لبيك اللهم عمره نو حج. A person now when he's doing tamattu, you're going to this first ihram is only for umrah. But the second ihram is going to be for hajj. When you're in Mecca and you leave and you stay in Mecca and you do your second ihram for hajj, that's when you're going to say labbaik allahumma hajja. But when you're in the outside, when you're at the miqat, you're only doing your intention for umrah, because you're going to do umrah, then you're going to leave the state of ihram and then you're going to do hajj in another ihram. You understand? Naam. And he says, لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رحمه الله تعالى لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فعل ذلك. Because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said he spoke the rituals, meaning the intention. That's what he means. لبيك اللهم حجا. والأفضل أن يكون التلفظ بذلك بعد استوائه على مركوبه من دابته أو سيارته أو غيرهما. لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إنما أهل بعدما استوى على راحلته وانبعث به من الميقات. وانبعثت به من الميقات للسير هذا هو الأصح من أقوال أهل العلم. And this person should do this when he's on his riding beast, he's on in his car, on the airplane. This is when you should say your intention. After you've done your ghusl and all of that, you go on your wherever you're leaving, you're about to leave the miqat, you're going on your riding beast and you're about to leave. And this is what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, done. And every hadith that mentions that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم made his intention for ihram off while he's not riding is not authentic. This was mentioned by Sheikh Salih Al-Usaymi وفقه الله تعالى. And he says, وَلَا يُشْرَعُ لَهُ التَّلَفُّظُ بِمَا نَوَى إِلَّا فِي الْإِحْرَامِ خَاصَّةِ لِوُرُودِهِ عَنِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمِ. And it is not legislated for a person to speak with his intention, meaning to say his intention except for in his ihram. And we mentioned that the other opinion is that even in ihram we don't say intention. Rather, what you're saying is not actually intention. It's just the speed. You're articulating the entering into rituals. التلفظ بالدخول في النسك. So you're not actually saying your intention. So even there, the other opinion is that even there, we're not saying your opinion. You're not saying your intention. Rather, you're just saying what type of hajj you're going to do. And he says, وأما الصلاة والطواف وغيرهما فينبغي له ألا يتلفظ شيء في شيء منها بالنية فلا يقول نويت أن أصلي كذا وكذا ولا نويت أن أطوف كذا بل التلفظ بذلك من البدع المحدثة والجهر بذلك أقبح وأشد إثما ولو كان التلفظ بالنية مشروعا لبينه الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم وأوضحه للأمة بفعله أو قوله ولا سبق إليه السلف الصالح. And he mentions that it is an innovation for a person to say the intention. That's what he mentioned basically in that paragraph. فلما لم ينقل ينقل ذلك عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولا عن الصحابة رضي الله عنهم علم أنه بدعة وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه بدعة وأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل بدعة ضلالة أخرجه مسلم في صحيحه. So he's basically saying that saying the intention is a innovation. فصل another chapter في المواقيت المكانية وتحديدها. He mentioned now the places of the ihram, and we already mentioned this before, but we're gonna go over again. الأول, the first place of the miqat is miqat أهل المدينة وهو ذو الحليفة وهو المسمى عند الناس اليوم أبيار علي. The people who come from Medina, the people who live in Medina, their miqat, the place where they are not allowed to pass before they go into ihram, is a place called ذو الحليفة, and this is the furthest miqat from Mecca. This is the furthest miqat from Mecca, meaning all the other miqat are actually closer to Mecca than this miqat. So this miqat is called Dhul Hulayfah, and it's for the people of Medina. Dhul Hulayfah, and it is for the people of Al-Madinah. نعم. And the people today, they call it Abyaru Ali. نعم. الثاني الجحفة, a place called Juhfa, وهو ميقات أهل الشام, وهي قرية خراب تلي رابغ, والناس اليوم يحرمون من رابغ. And this Juhfa is the miqat of the people of Sham. Al-Juhfa is the miqat of people of Sham. And we don't just mean only the people of Sham, by the way. It is the people of Sham, whoever comes back past Sham as well. Whoever comes from, for example, if you're going to Medina and Mecca, you go up to Sham. And what's after Sham? We have Russia, I think. So those people who come from that area as well, the people who come from Russia, they're also going to do their ihram from there. So we don't just mean the people of Sham, by the way. Whoever comes past Sham as well, they do their miqat from this place as well, which is called Dhul Juhfa. Now, about say Dhul Hulayfah. Really? I don't know. Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. The people from the UK, they also do it from Juhfa as well. And the Sheikh, he says that this place Juhfa now is a destroyed city. من أحرم من رابغ فقد أحرم من الميقات. Because and some people they do the ihram from رابغ instead of Juhfa because that place is destroyed, and so they do it from رابغ. And he says whoever does it from رابغ is also correct. الشيخ صالح العصيمي says واليوم أعيد بناؤها والناس يحرمون منها. Today the building of Juhfa has been rebuilt, so the people they actually do the ihram from Juhfa now, from Juhfa. So if now you go to Juhfa, you find that it is a place and it has a masjid where you can do your ihram from there as well. The third place of miqat is قرن المنازل. قرن المنازل وهو ميقات أهل النجد. And this is the miqat of the people of Najd. And the people of Najd are the eastern side. So whoever comes from Najd, for example, where is Najd? Where is other than Najd? After Najd, Iran, I think. And also, if you look at the map, after Riyadh and all that, those people who come from that area, the eastern side of Mecca, they do their miqat from قرن المنازل. So people who come from Iran and I think China as well. الرابع, the fourth one is اليلملم وهو ميقات أهل اليمن. اليلملم is the ميقات of the people of Yemen, and you come from Yemen. And below Yemen is Somalia. Australia, is Australia there as well? Or Antarctica, I don't know what's below Yemen. Australia come from the right, huh? They come from there. So they will be Najd, huh? Nah, so I don't think Australia is from there. But like in Antarctica, the South Pole, that place that comes from, it'll be Yelamram, right? Wallahu a'lam. And he says Al-Khamis, the fifth one. And these four were mentioned in the hadith. Okay, remember we mentioned that. These four are the ones that were mentioned in the hadith. And the fifth one is ذَاتُ عِرْقٍ وَهِيَ مِقَاتُ أَهْلِ الْعِرَاقِ. And this miqat is the miqat of the people of Iraq. And this miqat was not mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but rather it was mentioned by, we mentioned this, Umar bin Khattab, when عقد عليه الإجماع. Umar bin Khattab is the one who made this miqat, and there was a consensus after that this is a miqat for the people. نعم. الله أعلم. جزاك الله خير. نعم. الشيخ said that. Sheikh Saleh Al Usaymi mentions, he said there's no hadith. Sheikh Saleh Al Usaymi mentioned that there's no hadith for this. Like the Sheikh said that there is hadith and it's mentioned in Sunnah Al-Darimi. And this is ijtihad from Umar. And Sheikh Saleh Al Usaymi mentioned that it was al-ijma'. And Sheikh Abdul Rahman said that there is a hadith. Wallahu a'lam. وهذه المواقيت وقت so these مواقيت, these places that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told us لمن ذكرنا ومن عمر عليها من غيرها من غيرهم ممن أراد الحج والعمرة والواجب على من مر عليها أن يحرم منها ويحرم عليها أن يتجاوزها بدون إحرام إذا كان قاصدا مكة يريد حجا وعمرة سواء كان مروره عليها من طريق الأرض أو من طريق الجو لعموم قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما وقت هذه المواقيت هن لهن ولمن أتى عليهن من غير أهلهن ممن أراد الحج والعمرة. So he mentioned that it is haram now for any person to go past these places, and anyone who comes from that area, from Sham area or past Sham, anyone who comes from that, whether it be from the sea or whether it be from land or whether it be from the air, to go past these mawaqit without going into the state of ihram if he wants to do Hajj or Umrah. Because there is an opinion from the scholars that they say that any person who wants to come to Mecca, he has to do ihram and he has to do Umrah. He has to. But the Shaykh, he says that is not a strong opinion. And he says that the person, if he wants to do Hajj or Umrah, you're not allowed to go past these mawaqit. And you find, subhanAllah, people that they come to you in Mecca. And he says, I come from Sudan. I came from Sudan. He said to me, and he said, where do I do my ihram? And he's in Mecca. And you find that, wallahi, you find people, a lot of people, subhanAllah, it's because you got a beard, they come to you, they ask you for fatwa. And I say, I've done this and that. And you find, subhanAllah, that these rulings, they don't know, a lot of people don't know these rulings. And because of that, they fall into a lot of mistakes. And the ulama, they mention that a person, whatever is wajib upon him to do, then it is wajib upon him to know. It is wajib upon them to know. So if it's wajib upon you to pray, you have to know how to pray. If it's wajib upon you to do Hajj and you're going to do Hajj, you have to learn how to do Hajj. And if a person now does not learn how to do Hajj and then comes and does something that is haram upon him to do whilst in Hajj, then is he sinning or not? Does he have the udhur of jahl? No, he doesn't. He hasn't got an excuse for his ignorance. Because he had to learn how to do Hajj before he done the Hajj. And this is mentioned by a lot of the ulama, for amongst them Abu Abdullah ibn al-Qayyim. Ibn al-Qayyim, he mentions this. That a person, the knowledge that is wajib upon every single Muslim, it is the knowledge that is wajib upon him to do. Meaning, it is obligatory for every single person who has a certain amount of money to pay zakah. Therefore, it is wajib upon every single person who has that amount of money to know how to give zakah. You understand? It is wajib upon every single person to fast, who is above the age and is able to. Therefore, it is wajib upon every single person who is above the age and is able to know how to fast. Similarly, Hajj. It is wajib upon every person who is able to do Hajj, to do Hajj. Therefore, it is wajib for every person who is able to do Hajj, to know how to do Hajj. And this is something that is a principle that people should memorize, because it is something that is important. So it's not allowed for a person to go past these mawaqit without being in the state of ihram. And if a person does go past it, then they have to go back. They have to go back to the state of ihram and do the ihram after that. They have to go back to the miqat, sorry, and they have to do the ihram. And then he says, رحمه الله تعالى والمشروع لمن توجه إلى مكة من طريق الجو بقصد الحج والعمرة أن يتأهب لذلك بالغسل ونحوه قبل الركوب في الطائرة فإذا دنا من الميقات لبس إزاره ورداءه ثم لبى بالعمرة إن كان والوقت متسعا وإن كان الوقت ضيقا لبى بالحج وإن كان لبس إزاره ورداءه قبل الركوب أو قبل الدنو من الميقات فلا بأس ولكن لا ينوي الدخول في النزك ولا يلبي بذلك إلا إذا حاذ الميقات أو دنا منه. So now he mentions a contemporary issue, which is a person who's coming by plane. If a person now is coming by airplane, he says that it is sunnah for him to do his ghusl before he goes on the airplane. Before he goes on the plane, that's when he should do his ghusl and he should do all of these things, and then he goes on the plane. Well, then when he goes close to the miqat, then when he comes close to the miqat, he says his intention for the ihram. Always when he's on top of the miqat on the plane. And a lot of the airplanes, they'll tell you when you're on top of the miqat. And for safety, to take precaution, some of the ulama, they would actually do the ihram before. When they're on the airplane, Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah ta'ala, he used to go from Qasim to Mecca and he used to put his ihram on from Qasim when he's about to go on the airplane. And Qasim is around 1,000 kilometers from Mecca. And he used to do that. And Ibn Umar, rahimahullah, radiyallahu anhu, he done his ihram from Bayt al-Maqdis, Jerusalem. And Ibn al-Mundhir, rahimahullah ta'ala, quotes ijma' that a person who does his ihram before the miqat, that his ihram is correct. Ibn al-Mundhir in his kitab al-Ijma', he says that a person who does the ihram before the miqat, his ihram is correct. Then there is a difference of opinion on whether it is mustahab, recommended, or is it allowed, or is it makruh. The difference of opinion. But there's ijma', the consensus is what? That it is allowed, that is thing, it is authentic, it is correct. The ihram is correct. You understand? Na'am. Then he says, ولم يحرم إلا الميقات والواجب على الأمة التأسي به في ذلك كغيره من شؤون الدين. So he says that the person should do the ihram when they get to the miqat. And this is the opinion of a lot of the ulama, that they say that it is makruh, it is not allowed, it is not recommended for a person to do the ihram before they come to the miqat. And this is what Imam Malik said, that it's not recommended for a person to do the ihram before they come to the miqat, even though it is narrated from Ibn Umar. And some of the scholars, they say it is allowed. But Sheikh Ibn Baz, he says that, and obviously it is better to do it at the miqat. Ta'asiyan bin Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, following the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرُجُ اللَّهُ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Inside the Messenger of Allah, there is a good example for you, for whoever hopes in Allah and the last day. ولقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في حجة الوداع خذوا عني مناسككم وأما من توجه إلى مكة ولم يرد حجا ولا عمرة كالتاجر والحطاب والبريد ونحو ذلك فليس عليه إحرام إلا أن يرغب في ذلك لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في الحديث المتقدم لما ذكر المواقيت هن لهن ولمن أتى عليهن من غير أهلهن ممن أراد الحج والعمرة فمفهومه أن من مر على المواقيت ولم يرد حجا ولا عمرة فلا إحرام عليه وهذا من رحمة الله بعباده وتسهيله عليه عليهم فله الحمد والشكر على ذلك ويؤيد ذلك أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما فتح مكة عام الفتح لم يحرم بل دخلها وعلى رأسه المغفر ولكونه لم يرد حين ذاك حجا ولا عمرة وإنما أراد فتحها وإزالة ما فيها من الشرك. So in this paragraph he mentions that it is not obligatory for any person who enters into Mecca to be in a state of ihram unless they want Hajj or Umrah. And this is to refute the opinion of some of the scholars. They say that anyone who comes into Mecca, he has to do ihram. And some scholars do take that opinion, that anyone who comes to Mecca, you have to be in the state of ihram. You're not allowed to enter Mecca without the state of ihram. And the Sheikh, he goes against that. And that's the minority opinion, that it is not allowed. But the majority, they say that it's allowed for a person to go into Mecca without ihram. وأما من كان منسكه دون المواقيت كسكان جدة وأم السلم وبحرة والشراع وبدر والمستورة وأشباهها فليس عليه أن يذهب إلى شيء من المواقيت الخمسة المتقدم بل مسكنه هو ميقاته فيحرم منه بما أراد من حج أو عمرة وإذا كان له مسكن آخر خارج الميقات فهو بالخيار إن شاء أحرم من الميقات وإن شاء أحرم من مسكنه الذي هو أقرب من الميقات إلى مكة لعموم قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديث ابن عباس لما ذكر المواقيت قال ومن كان دون ذلك فمهله من أهله حتى أهل مكة يهلون من مكة أخرجه البخاري ومسلم. Then he mentions the ruling of a person who lives inside the miqat. So now we have a boundaries. Say Mecca is here, the mawaqid is one miqat here, one miqat here, one miqat here, and like that. We have mawaqid around Mecca. Whoever lives inside these places, for example, Jeddah. Jeddah is a city next to Mecca, around 75 kilometers from Mecca. There's no miqat between it and Mecca, meaning it is inside the grounds of the miqat. What does the person from Jeddah do, or anyone who is in that place, he does his ihram from his house. He does his ihram from his house. So he goes to his house, he does his ghusl, he's at his house, and he wears his ihram, and he says, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ عُمْرَةً, and he leaves and he goes to do his umrah or his hajj. لَكِنْ مَنْ أَرَادَ الْعُمْرَ وَهُوَ فِي الْحَرَمِ فَعَلَيْهِ أَنْ يَخْرُجَ إِلَى الْحِلِّ. And then he mentions the second thing, which is a person who lives in Mecca. So we mentioned three people. Well, everyone in the world doesn't come from out of the three people. Number one, either he lives in outside the miqat boundaries, and that person has to use miqat from the miqat. He has to use ihram from the miqat. And a person who lives within the miqat boundaries, where does he have to live? Where do he use ihram from? From his house. And the person who lives in Mecca. The person who lives in Mecca, for them to do umrah, they have to leave the place of the haram. You know, the Mecca, all of it is haram, and outside of it also, there are places, you know, the Prophet has told us the places where haram are, where Mecca are considered haram, sacred. Any person who wants to do umrah, he has to leave that sacred sanctity, the sacred place, and it's now there's signs to show where it stops and when it starts, the haram. And a person who wants to do umrah who lives in Mecca, he has to leave Mecca and do his ihram from outside of Mecca, from the hill, and then come back and do his umrah after that. And there's lots of places you can go to Tan'im, Masjid Aisha, which is a place called Tan'im, which is closer to the haram. There's another place, Jir'ana, which is another place. You have Hudaybiyah, also, which is outside the haram. You have Arafat, Ta'if, all of these places you can go there. And they're outside the haram. You go there and you do your ihram and then you come back. This is for the people of Mecca. And Shaykh Rahimahullah Ta'ala said this is the opinion of the majority of the ulama. And Shaykh Salih Al Usaymi said this is ijma' rather. He said rather this is consensus. Wallahu alim. And then he talks about وَأَمَّا مَا يَفْعَلُهُ بَعْضُ النَّاسِ مِنْ And this is the last point. وَأَمَّا مَا يَفْعَلُهُ بَعْضُ النَّاسِ مِنَ الْإِكْثَارِ مِنَ الْعُمْرَةِ بَعْدِ الْحَجِّ مِنَ التَّنْعِيمِ وَالْجَعْرَانَ أَوْ غَيْرِهِمَا وَقَدْ سَبَقَ أَنْ يَعْتَمَرَ قَبْلَ الْحَجِّ فَلَا دَلِيلَ عَلَى شَرْعِيَتِهِ بَلْ الْأَدِلَّةُ تَدُلُّ عَلَى أَنَّ الْأَفْضَلَ تَرْكُهُ لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه رضي الله عنهم لم يعتمروا بعد فراغهم من الحج وإنما اعتمرت عائشة من التنعيم لكونها لم تعتمر مع النبي الناس حين دخول مكة بسبب الحيض فطلبت من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن تعتمر بدلا من عمرتها التي أحرمت بها من الميقات فأجابها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى ذلك وقد حصلت لها العمرتان العمرة التي مع حجها وهذه العمرة مفردة فمن كان مثل عائشة فلا بأس أن يعتمر بعد فراغه من الحج عملا بالأدلة كلها وتوسعا على المسلمين ولا شك أن اشتغال الحجاج بعمرة أخرى بعد فراغهم من الحج سوى العمرة التي دخلوا بها مكة يشق على الجميع ويسبب كثرة الزحام والحوادث مع ما فيه من المخالفة لهدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وسنته والله الموفق. So in this last point he mentions the ruling of doing Umrah after you have already done Umrah or Hajj. And ما عليه الفتوى اليوم, the fatwa majority of the ulama you find in Mecca generally these days that the ulama, well, all of the ulama that I've seen in Mecca these days is that they say that whenever they ask, and they ask very often, that what is the ruling on a person who's already done Umrah for him to do another Umrah, they say that this is غير مشروع, this is not legislated, meaning that you don't say it's bid'ah. To say it's bid'ah, it will be quite it's far-fetched, and to say it's sunnah is also not what they give fatwa on, but they say it is غير مشروع, it's not legislated necessarily, meaning it's not the best, but it is allowed for a person who does it for a reason. So this is what they mentioned, that a person who does Umrah without a reason and they keep doing it, then this person, he's doing something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never done. So it's better for a person, and this is what the ulama they say these days in Mecca especially, they say that it's better for a person to busy themselves with reading Quran and Salah and doing Tawaf and not repeating Umrah. A lot of people these days, they find that they go to Mecca and they do their Umrah and they leave to Tan'im, Masjid Aisha, and do another Umrah, come back. And you find, wallah, I've seen some people do three Umrahs in one day. And it's narrated by Ata, the great Tabi'i, that he said, لا أدري أيؤجرون أم يؤزرون. I don't know if these people, they're being rewarded or they're sinning. And they keep doing Umrah three times. And this is something that the ulama, they speak about. Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala, he used to see that a person should only do Umrah once in a year. Why? Because if a person keeps doing Umrah, the ta'zeem, the greatness of Umrah becomes weak in his heart. It's like just something just walking, running, coming back, going. The three, four Umrahs in one day. This is what the Shaykh speaks about in this part. And he says that the people, that it's something that is not necessarily legislated, but whoever has a reason, you know, if there's a reason, who, like Aisha radiallahu anha, for example, when she had her period, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so she wanted to do Umrah after that, because she had a period, so she missed out. So she asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, can I go out and do my Umrah? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told her, yes, go to Tan'im, do another Umrah, and do it. So whoever's in that situation, then this is a hajj, it's a reason for them to do the Umrah. But as for what a lot of people do today, that they go to Mecca and they do three, four Umrah in one day, that this is something that is not legislated, and هذا ما عليه الفتوى اليوم عند أكثر العلماء في مكة. They find that most of the ulama in Mecca, they say that the fatwa that they give when they ask this is that it's something that is not necessarily legislated. Even though we can't say it's a bid'ah, but it's not something that is legislated. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.